Chapter 6 Tissues. From the last chapter, we recall that all living organisms are made up of cells. In unicellular organisms, a single cell performs all basic functions. For example, in amoeba, a single cell carries out movement, intake of food and gaseous exchange and excretion. But in multicellular organisms, there are millions of cells. Most of these cells are specialized to carry out specific functions. Each specialized function is taken up by a different groups of cells. Since these cells carry out only a particular function, they do it very efficiently. In human beings, muscle cells contract and relax to cause movement. Nerve cells carry messages, blood flows to transport oxygen, food, hormones and waste material, and so on. In plants, vascular tissues conduct food and water from one part of the plant to other part. So multicellular organisms show division of labor. Cells specializing in one function are often grouped together in the body. This means that a particular function is carried out by a cluster of cells at a definite place in the body. This cluster of cells, called a tissue, is arranged and designed so as to give the highest possible efficiency of function. Blood, phloem and muscles are all examples of tissues, a group of cells that are similar in structure and or work together to achieve a particular function forms a tissue. 6.1. Are plants and animals made of the same types of tissues? Let us compare their structure and functions. Do plants and animals have the same structure? Do they both perform similar functions? There are noticeable differences between the two. Plants are stationary or fixed. They don't move. Most of the tissues they have are supportive, which provides them with structural strength. Most of these tissues are dead. Since dead cells can provide mechanical strength as easily as live ones and need less maintenance. Animals, on the other hand, move around in search of food, mates and shelter. They consume more energy as compared to plants. Most of the tissues they contain are living. Another difference between animals and plants is in the pattern of growth. The growth in plants is limited to certain regions, while this is not so in animals. There are some tissues in plants that divide throughout their life. These tissues are localized in certain regions based on the dividing capacity of the tissues. Various plant tissues can be classified as growing or meristematic tissue and permanent tissue. Cell growth in animals is more uniform, so there is no such demarcation of dividing and non-dividing regions in animal. So there is no demarcation of dividing and non-dividing regions in animals. The structural organization of organs and organ system is far more specialized and localized in complex animals than even in very complex plants. This fundamental differences reflects the different modes of life pursued by these two major groups of organisms, particularly in their different feeding methods. Also, they are differently adapted for us. Sedentary existence on one hand, plants, and active locomotion on the other hand, animals, contributing to these differences in organ system design. It is with reference to these complex animal and plant bodies that we will now talk about the concept of tissue in some detail. Plant tissue. Meristematic tissue. Activity 6.1. Take two glass jars and fill them with water. Now take two onion bulbs and place one on each jar, as shown in figure 6.1. Observe the growth of the roots in both the bulbs for a few days. Measure the length of the roots on day 1, 2 and 3. On day 4, cut the root tips of the onion bulb in jar 2 by about 1 cm. After this, observe the growth of roots in both the jars and measure their lengths each day for 5 more days and record the observations in table like the table below. From the above observations, answer the following questions. Which of the two onions has longer roots and why? Do the roots continue growing even after we have removed their tips? Why would the tips stop growing in jar 2 after we cut them? The growth of plants occurs only in certain specific regions. This is because the dividing tissue, also known as meristematic tissue, is located only at these points. Depending upon the region where they are present, meristematic tissue are classified as apical, lateral, and intercalary. New cells produced by the meristem are initially like those of meristem itself, but as they grow and mature, their characteristics slowly change and they become differentiated as components of other tissues. Apical meristem is present at the growing tips of stems and roots and increases the length of the stem and the root. The growth of the stem or root increases due to lateral meristem, that is cambium. Intercalary meristem seen in some plants is located near the node. Cells of a meristematic tissue are very active. They have dense cytoplasm, thin cellulose walls, and prominent nuclei. They lack vacuoles. Can we think why they would lack vacuoles? You might want to refer to the functions of vacuoles in the chapter on the cells. Permanent tissue. What happens to the cells formed by meristematic tissue? They take up a specific role and lose the ability to divide. As a result, they form a permanent tissue. This process of taking up a permanent shape, size, and a function is called differentiation. Differentiation leads to the development of various types of permanent tissue. Activity 6.2. Take a plant stem and, with the help of your teacher, cut into very thin slices or sections. Now strain the slices with a safarin. Place one neatly cut section on a slide and put a drop of glycerin. Cover with a cover slip and observe under microscope. Observe the various types of cells and their arrangement. Compare it with the figure 6.3. Now answer the following on the basis of your observations. Are all cells similar in structure? How many types of cells can be seen? Can we think of reasons why there would be so many types of cells? We can also try to cut sections of plant roots. We can even try cutting sections of root and stem of different plants. First, simple permanent tissue. A few layers of cells beneath the epidermis are generally simple permanent tissue. Parenchyma is the most common simple permanent tissue. It consists of a relatively unspecialized cells with thin cell walls. They are living cells. They are usually loosely arranged. Thus, large spaces between the cells, intercellular spaces, are found in this tissue. This tissue generally stored food. In some situations, it contains chlorophyll too and perform photosynthesis, and then it is called chlorenchyma. In aquatic plants, large air cavities are present in parenchyma to help them float. Such parenchyma type is called anenchyma. The flexibility in plants is due to the another permanent tissue, cholenchyma. It allows the bending in various parts of the plant, like dendrites and stems of climbers, without breaking. It also provides mechanical support. We can find this tissue in leaf stalks below the epidermis. The cells of this tissue are living, elongated, and irregularly thickened at the corners. There is a very little intercellular space. At another type of permanent tissue is sclerenchyma. It is a tissue which makes the plant hard and stiff. We have seen the husk of a coconut. It is made up of sclerenchymatous tissue. The cells of this tissue are dead. They are long and narrow, as the walls are thickened due to lignin often. These walls are so thick that there is no internal space inside the cell. This tissue is present in stems and around vascular bundles, in the veins of leaves, and in the hard covering of seeds and nuts. It provides strength to the plant parts. 6.3. Activity 6.3. Take a freshly plucked leaf of rue, stretch and break it, applying pressure. While breaking it, keep it stretched gently so that some peel or skin protects out from the cut. Remove this peel and put it in a petri dish filled with water. Add a few drops of safarin, wait for a couple of minutes, and then transfer to a slide. Gently place a cover slip over it, observe under microscope. What you observe in the outermost layer of the cells called epidermis. The epidermis is usually made of single layer of cells. In some plants living in very dry habitats, the epidermis may be thicker since protection against water loss is critical. The entire surface of a plant has this outer covering of epidermis. It protects all the parts of the plant. Epidermal cells on the aerial parts of the plant often secrete a waxy, water-resistant layer on their outer surface. This aids in protection against loss of water, mechanical injury, and invasion by parasitic fungi. Since it has a protective role to play, cells of epidermal tissue form a continuous layer without intercellular spaces. Most epidermal cells are relatively flat. Often their outer and side walls are thicker than the inner walls. We can observe small pores here and there in the epidermis in the leaf. These pores are called stomata. Stomata are enclosed by the two kidney-shaped cells called guard cells. They are necessary for exchanging gases with the atmosphere. Transpiration, loss of water in the form of water vapor, also takes place through stomata. Epidermal cells of the roots, whose function is water absorption, commonly bear long hair-like parts that greatly increase the total absorptive surface area. In some plants, like desert plants, epidermis has a thick waxy coating of cutin, chemical substances with waterproof quality on its outer surface. Can we think of a reason for this? Is the outer layer of a branch of a tree different from the outer layer of a young stem? As plants grow older, the outer protective tissue undergoes certain changes. A strip of secondary meristem located in the cortex forms layers of cells which constitute the cork. Cells of a cork are dead and compactly arranged without intercellular spaces. They also have a chemical called suberin in their walls that makes them impervious to gases and water. Complex permanent tissue. The different types of tissues we have discussed until now are all made up of one type of cells, which look like each other. Such tissues are called simple permanent tissues. And another type of permanent tissue is complex tissue. Complex tissues are made up of more than one type of cells. All these cells coordinate to perform a common function. Xylem and phloem are examples of such complex tissue. They are both conducting tissues and constitute a vascular bundle. Vascular tissue is a distinctive feature of the complex plants, one that has made possible their survival in the terrestrial environment. In figure 6.3, showing a section of stem, can you see different types of cells in the vascular bundle? Xylem consists of tracheids, vessels, xylem, parenchyma, and xylem fibers. Tracheids and vessels have thick walls and many are dead cells when mature. This allows them to transport water and minerals vertically. The parenchyma stores food. Xylem fibers are mainly supportive in function. Phloem is made up of five types of cells, sieve tubes, companion cells, phloem fibers, and the phloem parenchyma. Figure 6.7d. Sieve tubes are tubular cells with the perforated walls. Phloem transports food from the leaves to the other parts of the plant. Except phloem fibers, other phloem cells are living cells. Animal tissue. When we breathe, we can actually feel the movement of our chest. How do these body parts move? For this, we have specialized cells called muscle cells. The contraction and relaxation of these cells result in the movement. During breathing, we inhale oxygen. Where does this oxygen go? It is absorbed in the lungs and then it is transported to all the body cells through the blood. Why would cells need oxygen? The functions of mitochondria we studied earlier provide a clue to this question. Blood flows and carries various substances from one part of the body to the other. For example, it carries oxygen and food to all the cells. It also collects wastes from all parts of the body and carries them to the liver and kidney for disposal. Blood and muscles are both examples of tissues found in our body. On the basis of the functions they perform, we can think different types of animals' tissues, such as epithelial tissue, connective tissue, muscular tissue, and nervous tissue. Blood is a type of connective tissue, and muscle forms muscular tissue. First, epithelial tissue. The covering or protective tissue in the animal body are epithelial tissue. Epithelial covers most organs and cavities within the body. It also forms a barrier to keep different body systems separate. The skin, the lining of the mouth, the lining of the blood vessels, lung, alveoli, and Kidney tubules are all made up of epithelial tissue. Epithelial tissue cells are tightly packed and form a continuous sheet. They have only a small amount of cementing material between them and almost no intercellular spaces. Obviously, anything entering or leaving the body must cross at least one layer of the epithelium. As a result, the permeability of the cells of various epithelia play an important role in regulating the exchange of materials between the body and the external environment and also different parts of the body. Regardless of the type, all epithelium is usually separated from the underlying tissue by an extracellular fibrous basement membrane. Different epithelia, figure 6.9, show differing structures that correlate with their unique functions. For example, in cells lining blood vessels or lung alveoli, where transportation of substances occur through the selective permeable surface. There is a simple flat line kind of epithelium. This is called simple squamous epithelium. Squama means scale of skin. Simple squamous epithelial cells are extremely thin and flat and form a delicate lining. The esophagus and the lining of the mouth are also covered with the squamous epithelium. The skin which protects the body is also made up of squamous epithelium. Skin epithelial cells are arranged in many layers to prevent wear and tear. Since they are arranged in a pattern of layers, the epithelium is called stratified squamous epithelium, where absorption and secretion occur as in the inner lining of the intestine. The tall epithelial cells are present. This polymer, meaning pillar-like epithelial, facilitates movement across the epithelial barrier. In the respiratory tract, the columnar epithelial tissue also has cilia, which are hair-like projections on the outer surface of the epithelial cells. These cilia can move and their movement pushes the mucus forward to clear it. This type of epithelium is thus ciliated columnar epithelium. Cuboidal epithelium with cube-shaped cells forms the lining of kidney tubules and ducts of salivary glands, where it provides mechanical support. Epithelial cells often acquire additional specialization as gland cells, which can secrete substances at the epithelial surface. Sometimes, a portion of the epithelial tissue folds inward and multicellular glands is formed. This is a glandular epithelium. Connective tissue. Blood is a type of connective tissue. Why would it be called connective tissue? A clue is provided in the introduction of this chapter. Now let us look at this type of tissue in some more detail. The cells of a connective tissue are loosely spaced and embedded in an intercellular matrix. Figure 6.10. The matrix may be jelly-like, fluid, dense or rigid. The nature of the matrix differs in the concordance with the function of the particular connective tissue. Blood has a fluid liquid matrix called plasma, in which red blood cells, RBCs, white blood corpuscles, that is WBCs, and platelets are suspended. The plasma contains protein cells and hormones. The blood flows and transports gases, digested food, hormones, and waste material to different parts of the body. Bone is another example of connective tissue. It forms the framework that supports the body. It also anchors the muscles and supports the main organs of the body. It is a strong and non-flexible tissue. What would be the advantages of these properties for bone functions? Bone cells are embedded in a hard matrix that is composed of calcium and phosphorus compounds. Two bones can be connected to each other by another type of connective tissue called the ligament. This tissue is a very elastic. It is a considerable strength. Ligaments contain very little matrix and connect bones with the bones. Tendons connect muscles to bones and are another type of a connective tissue. Tendons are fibrous tissue with great strength but limited flexibility. Another type of a connective tissue is a cartilage. Has widely spaced cells. The solid matrix is composed of proteins and sugars. Cartilage smoothens bone surfaces at joints and is also present in the nose, ear, trachea and larynx. We can fold the cartilage of the ears, but we cannot bend the bones in our arms. Think of how the two tissues are different. Areolar connective tissue is found between the skin and muscles, around blood vessels and nerves, and in the bone marrow. It fills the space inside the organs supports internal organs and helps in the repair of tissues. Where are fats stored in our body? Fat storing adipose tissue is found below the skin and between internal organs. The cells of this tissue are filled with the fat globules. Storage of fat also less. It acts as an insulator. Muscular tissue. Muscular tissue consists of elongated cells also called muscle fibers. This tissue is responsible for movement in our body. Muscles contain special proteins called contractile proteins, which contract and relax to cause movement. We can move some muscles by conscious will. Muscles present in our limbs move when we want to them and stop when we so decide. Such muscles are called voluntary muscles. These muscles are also called skeletal muscles as they are mostly attached to bone and help in body movement. Under the microscope, these muscles show alternate light and dark bands and striations when stained approximately. As a result, they are also called striated muscles. The cells of this tissue are long, cylindrical, unbranched, and multinucleated, having many nuclei. The movement of food in the alimentary canal or contraction and relaxation of blood vessels are involuntary movements. We cannot really start them or stop them simply by wanting to do so. Smooth muscles, figure 6.11b, are involuntary muscles control such movements. They are also found in the iris of our eye, in ureterus, and in the bronchi of the lungs. The cells are long with the pointed ends, spindle-shaped, and uninucleate, having a single nucleus. They are also called unstriated muscles. Why would they be called that? The muscles of the heart show rhythmic contraction and relaxation throughout the life. These involuntary muscles are called cardiac muscles. Figure 6.11c. Heart muscles cells are cylindrical, branched, and uninucleated. 6.3.4. Nervous tissue. All cells possess the ability to respond to stimuli. However, cells of the nervous tissue are highly specialized for being stimulated and then transmitting the stimulus very rapidly from one place to another within the body. The brain, spinal cord, and the nerves are all composed of the nervous tissue. The cells of this tissue are called nerve cells or neurons. A neuron consists of a cell body with a nucleus and cytoplasm, from which long thin hair-like parts arise. Usually, each neuron has a single long part called the axon and many short branch parts called dendrites. An individual nerve cell may be up to a meter long. Many nerve fibers bound together by connective tissue may make up a nerve. The signal that passes along the nerve fiber is called as an impulse. That impulse, nerve impulse, allow us to move our muscles when we want to. The functional combination of nerve and muscle tissue is fundamental to most animals. This combination enables animals to move rapidly in response to stimuli. Thank you.